Presenting on behalf of the group Satluj, can my friends just raise their heads? Yeah, thank you. Friends from the group only. Okay, we had a long discussion right from the 3D connectivity, which the last group presented this, and it's linked to biodiversity. We also transgressed the territory and discussed about issues and threats, and you know, closed with recommendations. So we'll be presenting that to these different types of riverine habitats which have biodiversity implications, and the different types of biodiversity in the riverine systems. And the most important thing is the biodiversity and its utility aspect considering food and livelihood, and end up with the issues and recommendations. Looking at the, when we discuss about the habitats and we look at this whole three dimensions, we discussed about the source of river and their biodiversity in that geographical location, the main channel, the side channels, different drainage systems in the river and their biodiversity and endemism. The river beds, when they're dried up, they're also used for cultivation of agriculture, and that way there is another biodiversity element coming into that. And the river bank landage, where you find the grasses to fodder to, you know, these vegetables. And also, of course, estuarine zone. So these are the some kind of geographical element, latitudinal and longitudinal, where the biodiversity are discussed. And there are, of course, some typical and niche habitat which are not common across all the rivers, but specific to some rivers like Oxbow Lakes. And one of the interesting data shared with us that out of the 111 habitats of Siberian crane, now only 11 are existing, and hundreds which have been vanished are Oxbow Lakes. So that way, that is one of the pristine habitat which is going away. The river islands in most of the river systems, bigger river systems, the wetlands, the mangroves, and also some niche habitats, like we discussed about dolphins, and where it was also informed that where in Chambal Ravine, Chambal River, it required 20 feet of water, and there are some places where only 2 meters of water they are surviving. So it is not only the depth of river flow, it is also the other conditions of detritus availability and floral and faunal element which affect that. Then regarding the types of biodiversity, apart from faunal biodiversity, including fish and other lower vertebrates, we also discuss about microbial biodiversity. The aquatic flora, which is also used as a big source of food in most of the riparian ecosystems. The river bed and the bank agrobiodiversity, traditional species, many traditional varieties which are being now lost. And of course, the mangrove diversity is coming as a dynamism of interplay of silt and saline dynamics. Regarding the utilitarian aspect, we found that the food baskets of the riparian ecosystems are linked to, hugely to the river biodiversity, particularly the flora and fauna and the small fishes. And they being a common source of food, it is a food commons, and mostly the poor and, the aspect of equity is linked to that. So it is now getting affected. Water quality, it was also raised by Dr. Brijesh Gopal that, this vertical interconnection, how it is affecting the water quality, how the microbial population also influencing the better quality of river water, and it is one of the biodiversity services that we are getting through water. Livelihoods, lots of livelihoods around the riparian systems are linked to this biodiversity of fisheries, river bank and bank agriculture, riparian forest and their NTFP, animal husbandry and mangroves. Then we tried to discuss about, and it was coming up again and again, though there is another session on threats, but it came up again and again, what are the issues that affect biodiversity. So it is the, most of the groups they have highlighted, it is the loss of connections. The connectivity is getting affected across time and space, the longitudinal, lateral and vertical connectivity, which is affecting the biodiversity. The different governance and growth models we are adopting, it is also affecting. The water allocation for biodiversity was discussed, starting from e-flow to artificial fluctuations in the rivers, the water requirement of different species and how they are available, the time and duration of dryness in the rivers. It was discussed that in the Chambal River, if all the dams they are planned, out of 400 kilometer stretch, around 170 kilometer stretch will be dry. So how it is going to affect the biodiversity there? And then the mangroves, when we talk about no drop to ocean, we want all the water to be used for agriculture and other uses, so how the mangroves would survive? There are also discussion that how the maximum flow during the peak flows, this 100-year variation flows, they are affecting biodiversity. And I think there has been very less number of studies around that. The impact of flood on biodiversity, the floodplain and biodiversity, floodplain and these land uses, the positive aspect of it was also discussed. And it was also thought that the river governance and more about understanding the way the river is also affect the biodiversity. There is also discussion about the conservation of biodiversity. When you talk about the protected area network, how while conserving the rivers as part of core area is also affecting the utilitarian aspect of the biodiversity. That was also discussed because many places it is community are not allowed to have rights over biodiversity. Then we discuss about the pollution and solid waste that are coming to river bodies, how they are affecting biodiversity, this unregulated river tourism and various religious and cultural practices, transportation and navigation, how they are affecting, and also this whole riverbank and riverbed agriculture and the fisheries, when they are migrating from tradition to commercialization motives, how they are affecting the biodiversity. And based on that, this is the last slide about recommendations. We felt that there is very inadequate documentation on biodiversity or biodiversity use, particularly around riverine systems and the threats. So while going for documentation, we need to rely more on the traditional ecological knowledge, oral history, apart from supplementing that with the theoretical knowledge. And there should be, we should also document the process of community conservation, the governance, the local ecological knowledge around riverine biodiversity, the endemism. The status of pan riverine vegetation, the strips, you know, vegetation strips around the river, natural vegetation, that need to be also documented, the biodiversity. And it should be a participatory, multidisciplinary processes through which it should be documented. And there was a recommendation that it should be mandatory to develop the baseline of biodiversity in all the rivers. And no EIS should be taken up without having the baseline documentation of the biodiversity. Similarly, other recommendations were restoration of connectivity and the species back to habitat, is both three-dimensional connectivity. That should not be allow the commercialization of different river spaces. The institutional linkages across river stretches among the communities, among the departments should be promoted for this collective action. The river bank vegetation strip should be maintained with this river regulation zones. And community conservation areas around rivers should be promoted. And most importantly, whatever existing legal framework is there and what are new are coming, important thing is that how it should be legally enforceable. Thank you.
Thank you. And questions, comments? संक्षिप्त में बोलेंगे आप, क्योंकि आप प्रोफेसर हैं और बहुत बोल सकते हो।
आप बोलने कहा लेंगे हमको जी। मैं प्रणव भाई के ही ग्रुप में था, लेकिन वो हम सुनने में इतने, हमारे ग्रुप में इतने बेहतरीन लोग थे कि हम सुनने और सीखने में ही रह गए, बोलने से चूक गए। मैं सिर्फ इतना जोड़ना चाहता हूँ कि जब नदियों के संदर्भ में बायोडाइवर्सिटी की बात कर रहे हैं तो दो चीज़ें बड़ी क्लियर हमारे दिमाग में आनी चाहिए। एक जो नदियों के अलोंग या ट्रिब्यूटरीज के अलोंग हम बायोडाइवर्सिटी की बात कर रहे हैं, एक जो उसका लार्जर कैचमेंट है उसके संदर्भ में वो अक्सर छूट जाता है। वो अक्सर हमें, वो एक तो उसकी विजिबिलिटी नहीं रहती है और न हमारी और न एक्सपर्ट्स की रहती है, तो छूट जाता है। तो ये दोनों का लिंक होना चाहिए। मैं इसमें जोड़ना चाहता हूँ कि हिमालय की नदियाँ और उनका जो जलागम है, अगर उसके संदर्भ में बायोडाइवर्सिटी देखें तो वह भी इसमें नेगलेक्ट हो जाती है। हाल के वर्षों में जब से डैम, जब से सड़कें, जब से डायनामाइटिंग, जब से मिलिट्री, जब से ITBP और जब से हम मध्यम वर्ग हिमालय को रौंदने के लिए निकल चलते हैं, तब से बायोडाइवर्सिटी पर ज़बरदस्त तरीके का दबाव पड़ा है। और अगर उसकी तरफ और इशारा किया जाए तो जो करीबन फूट हिल्स से लेकर ट्रांस हिमालय तक की तकरीबन 250 किलोमीटर की जो चौड़ाई है, उसमें जितनी बायोडाइवर्सिटी है वो अलार्मिंग है, वो मतलब असाधारण है। अगर आपको फूट हिल्स में गैंडा मिल रहा है, हाथी मिल रहा है और बंगाल टाइगर मिल रहा है, और 200 किलोमीटर ऊपर आपको कस्तूरा मृग, हिमचितुआ, मोनाल और बहुत सारे और चीज़ें मिल रही हैं। तो मेरा ये निवेदन है कि जब भी खास तरीके से नॉर्दर्न इंडियन रिवर्स की बात हो तो ये जो हिमालयन कनेक्टिविटी और हिमालयन, बल्कि मैं तो कहूँगा ट्रांस हिमालयन बायोडाइवर्सिटी भी, क्योंकि वहाँ परहेज नहीं है कि गंगा के जलागम से जो वाइल्ड लाइफ है वो सतलज के जलागम में भी चली जाती है, और इधर जो अरुण नदी के जलागम से वो तीस्ता के जलागम में भी जा सकती है, और इसी तरीके से उस तरफ ब्रह्मपुत्र में भी जा सकती है। तो ये कनेक्टिविटी जो बहुत ज़्यादा एक तरीके से नेगलेक्टेड है हमारी समझदारी में भी, वो ज़रूर उत्तरी भारत के संदर्भ में जोड़ी जानी चाहिए। थैंक यू।
That's absolutely brilliant. It's the shortest speech by Shekhar I've ever heard.
सर, एक छोटा सा कमेंट है। मैं जो बायोलॉजिकल इन्वेजियन है उसके ऊपर हमें थोड़ा सा ध्यान देना पड़ेगा, क्योंकि एक्वेटिक इकोसिस्टम में हम लोग इस चीज़ को नज़रअंदाज करते जा रहे हैं। जो एक्वेटिक इन्वेजिव स्पीसीज़ हैं एज वेल एज जो उनके अलॉन्ग विद जो टेरेस्ट्रियल इकोसिस्टम है, उनकी जो इन्वेजिव एलियन स्पीसीज़ हैं इंक्लूडिंग फॉनल एंड फ्लोरल, इनको फोकस, इनको ध्यान में रखने की बहुत ज़रूरत है। अदरवाइज मैं एक जस्ट एग्जांपल दे रहा हूँ कि अगर पाइन का ही लोकल इन्वेजियन अगर आप देखें उत्तराखंड में, लोकल इन्वेजियन पाइन का, जिसके कारण वहाँ की नदियों के अंदर जो पानी का आना, उनका रिचार्ज पैटर्न जो अफेक्ट हो रहा है, वो समझा जा सकता है। लोकल इन्वेजियन की बात है, लेकिन अगर इसमें एलियन फ्लोरा भी अगर आता है बाहर का, मान लीजिए प्रोस्पिस जोली फ्लोरा भी आता है, और अगर लेंटेना का मीनेक तो उत्तराखंड, हिमाचल और इसमें प्रसिद्ध है, तो अगर लेंटेना कैमरा का इन्वेजन भी है, एंड दैट इज़ गोइंग टू चेंज द होल रिचार्ज पैटर्न ऑफ दीज रिवर्स एंड स्ट्रीम्स। सो दैट इज़ माई अर्ज दैट नॉट ओनली दीज टेरिस्ट्रियल स्पीसीज बट एक्वेटिक इन्वेजन शुड ऑल्सो बी कंसिडर्ड एंड टेकन इन टू कंसिडरेशन। दैट्स इट। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू।
थैंक यू। Any other comments, questions? People are getting hungry.
Yes.
So, shall we thank Pranab? Thank you very much, Pranab. And on behalf of both of us, the senior partner will do the summing up.
Thank you. I think today's session had four different topics, but they all converged to two things. One, the health and well-being of the river, and the other, connectivity. Each group spoke about the importance of both these factors. In fact, flow, floods, form of the river and biodiversity, they are so interconnected that naturally, the common links will always be there. I think that a point that can be highlighted other than what has been said is that much influence on the river is because of what happens outside the river than what happens on or in the river, such as the example given by Professor regarding the invasion of pine. So that way, I think the older concept of river action plans, which concentrated merely on the inflow into the river and nothing else, has really to be replaced with an overview which encompasses the entire basin, not merely a stem of a river. Thank you for the time given to me.
Thank you all, and I won't detain you. Let's go for lunch.
I will detain you.
Oh, you want to detain?
I will detain for a moment.
Ab tumhara to koi ilaaj hai nahi.
So I would like to really thank the chair and the co-chair for really ensuring that this the time period for lunch remains at least for half an hour. Now, thank you very much, sir. And the presentations were great. My request is to the conveners, if you could please provide us a para or two maybe a summary of your observations and findings, that will be very helpful to us. Now we would break for lunch. The lunch break is only for half an hour. Pardon me. Lunch break is only for half an hour. We will begin at 2:30, and because we are going to have a very lively debate in the evening, and we need to really keep to the time to ensure that we are able to give that time to the debate as well. Thank you very much for your time, and pardon me for reducing the lunch break. And all the groups, please, straight away after lunch, go to the breakaway groups.